Okay, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to another episode of Expert Reviews here on Pilsen with a Prosciutto 66, or two of them. As in this case, we have a platoon, both anonymized by the looks of it. Now, what can I read into this immediately? This is an old patch, so I can't see the equipment, or maybe that's just to do with the field mods. Either way, one thing I notice immediately, I'm looking at the health bar of this Prosciutto right here, 2060 hit point. Now, base hit point value of the Prosciutto, 1850. We can see that on this Prosciutto right here. So I would guess that the benefit of improved hardening on this vehicle and that his friend there in the other Prosciutto is not in fact using improved hardening. So interesting thing to note there. Now, what can we talk about with regards to the Prosciutto 66? Well, it has one of those auto reloaders. The Italian heavies do work those quite well with that special mechanic where the reload of the next shell gets shorter and shorter and shorter as you get closer to loading the next shell in, which is an interesting dynamic. I'm curious to see how they work it, or how this particular individual works it in this game, because it can get quite finicky with when you want to fire the shell. You're just waiting that half a second for the shell to load, or do you take the shell immediately? Now, let's talk about gun stats, and Armand just realizing that there's no tank audio, so I'm going to reverse and hopefully get that going. But yeah, let's talk about gun stats. 4.62 rounds per minute doesn't really mean a huge amount in an auto reloader, naturally, but you've got 242 nanometers with your standard AP, that's penetration, 303 with your heat, and 120 with HE, which is why I'm a bit surprised to see him only take 3. 120 HE is gargantuan. That is really, really good to have. So I'd expect most Prosciuttos to be lugging about 4 or 5 HE shells at least. Goes up from 400 alpha to 515, which isn't remarkable, but with 120 millimeters of pen, the amount of vehicles that is viable on is pretty damn large, even at tier 9. Now you've got 0.36 accuracy and you've got 2.7 second aim time. So gun isn't remarkable. It's certainly a heavy tank gun, what you'd expect from it, but it is 0.02 more accurate than the Manticore, but that's mostly because the Manticore's shit. Now, let's talk about armor, shall we? In terms of profile, you've got 130 on the front of the hull, 70 at the side and 40 at the rear. That's a bit more nuanced, but we'll get to that in a second. The turret, 195 at the front, 105 at the side, and 105 at the rear. Now let's talk weak spot, shall we? Look at that lower plate. That's quite an angle on that lower plate. What gorgeous text engraved in there. 100mm base, right? Not 130, 100. The effective value, if you're shooting flat on at it, is about 200 millimeters, so perfectly viable to pen for tier 9 vehicles. Now, the upper plate is base 130. Interestingly enough, there is a 250 millimeter plate right there, so if you hit there, you're going to get really unlucky. That'll be funny. 130 on the upper plate, with an effective of about 220. When this tank sidescrapes, these cheeks do present as weak spots in the same fashion that they might on an IS-4 or something like that. So if this tank is sidescraping at a corner at you, shoot above the tracks there. You've got about maybe 220, 230. You'll most likely get a pen. As for the turret, this thing's cupolas do not exist. Do not bother shooting at them. Don't shoot at that. It's not modeled into the tank. Don't shoot at that. It's not modeled into the tank. This thing does not have cupolas. That said, it's not immortal hold down by any means. 195mm of armor is in this square band, both to the left and right of the gun mantlet. So if you hit there, despite the angle that it's at, you'll get about 250mm, assuming it's on flat land looking at you. So that is a viable weak spot for tier 9 and 10 opponents, certainly. One thing that's worth noting as well is that the side turret being 105, if you even get the slightest angle, like his gun's off-center looking over there, that is a clean pen. right there. That presents a weak spot of less than 200 millimeters, easy. So worth looking out for if a Pongello is not paying attention. You can sneak a penning shot in there quite easily in the same fashion as when it angles the hull. So now that we've covered armor, we know what we're looking at. We know what we're expecting to get penetrated by. Here we are rolling out on Pilsen to a top speed of 45 with 12 in reverse. And doesn't look like he's utilizing a turbocharger on this tank. As we know, it's an auto-reloader, so you can't use a gun hammer. So I'm curious as to what his equipment is. Perhaps an aiming device, perhaps vents. What else would you use on a heavy tank if you can't use a hammer? Tell me, what's your equipment on the Pongello? I did notice he switched to heat, anticipating a heavy engagement, no doubt. You know, 20mm of pen isn't the best, but at tier 9, it's certainly viable for the majority of targets that he's going to be facing here. Now, not side-scraping around this corner, and does take a shot, presumably either through the drive wheel or through the upper plate. I mean, if we look at this, it's moderately pike-nosed. It's like a WZ11114 or a 110, something like that. So it will have that same weakness. If you're poking around like this, the entirety of the upper plate is going to present a viable weak spot for the same tier opponents. So potentially worth a side-scrape there, but if you side-scrape for that corner, you are very exposed to that one. So it is difficult. Start of the game, we're just exploring here. Right, this is where maybe you take a bit of damage to just figuring out position. You want to know where the enemy tank is, and it looks like he knows his weak spots. That was the area that we talked about earlier, the flat cheeks on the front of this tank that present about 250mm of armor, so these heat shells with 303mm of pen are just going to butter through them. Now, we want to observe as we're getting into the combat here, finds another pen, lovely. Object 777 has just been spotted. He's platooned with the Pongello that's not been spotted, so we can assume that the Pongello is over there with him, right? People that are platooned with each other tend to stay in the same place or go to the same flanks. So one would assume that that Pongello is also going to soon be spotted over on this flank. And I doubt these people are going to have a good day given the gargantuan amount of our team that is over there. We have no light tanks present in this game. My bad, we did have light tanks in this game, but they died so quickly that I didn't notice. GG light tanks, well done. Well, as of now, we have no light tanks left in this game, so this entire flank is just going to be basically a lucky dip in terms of positioning. That's going to be a kerfuffle. But I would wager we probably have more tanks over there than they do. Well, at least I would hope, unless both teams have decided that camping is the better way to demonstrate valor in a World of Tanks game. Now, I think it may become sort of irrelevant in this game. This tank does have 9 degrees of gun depression, 4 over the rear. Isn't that nice? 20 degrees of gun elevation, should you ever need that. But I mean, given that this thing has no cupolas at any point, I can't make a point like I would on the M103 or something like that, that when you use all of your gun depression in this vehicle, should take a pen here, and he does, when you use all of your gun depression in this vehicle, yes, it does help. It does help, but not to the same degree that it would in an M103, because in an M103, you've got a gargantuan cupola here, and you've got an overmatchable region on top. Not the case on this. You've got 52mm on the top. Ain't nothing going to overmatch that apart from Death Star AP. And Jagdpanzer AP as well, but, you know, niche situations, not going to be overmatched in most. One that does help is obviously the angle of this frontal armor. You can see it's already sloped, and if you're using 9 degrees of gun depression, you can imagine that armor is going to be intensified massively. So it does help to use gun depression, but unlike the M103, you're not concealing any cupolas on the roof or any overmatch points on your roof when you use gun depression. So I'd say it's less of an asset on this tank than it might be on a tank that presents viable weak spots on the top. Now, we are missing at this point a Centurion 7-1, a Skoda T50, and a Beezy. Now, let's make a quick observation. I'm sorry I'm pausing so often, but another observation for you. Beezy just killed the SU-130, which we can lead into a little bit. Where is the Beezy? He's not been spotted. He just got a kill. Where is that SU-130? Nowhere on this flank. That means the SU-130 must have been on the other flank, which means the Beezy must be either there or there. He's on the right side of this map. We can do the same thing with the Skoda T-50. Skoda T-50 has got a kill. What has died over here? Nothing. Therefore, we know the Skoda T-50 is over the other side. Useful information. Borsig, SU-130, Scorpion. These are things that we want to fill in. We want to fill in blanks of the enemy team. Find out where we are so that will tell us if we are numerically overmatched on this flank, if we have a weakness on it, or if we have an advantage that we can potentially exploit. And learning stuff like that can really help. If I knew, for example, where all of the enemy tanks were, it would tell me in this engagement, okay, do I want to play passively? Because if I know that we're outnumbered on this flank, then I play passively, I keep my hit points, and I try and make it as hard for the enemy team to push into me as I possibly can, because we are mathematically probable to win the enemy flank based on the fact that we have a numerical overmatch there. And if we win the enemy flank, the other flank, then we start feeling pressure, the enemy team starts feeling pressure from the flank and the threat on their base, which weakens this area. On the other hand, if I knew where everything was and it's clear that we have a numerical overmatch, then I want to push on this flank, because if you have a numerical overmatch on one flank, then you have a numerical disadvantage on the other. It's yin and yang. It's important to know all the variables because it can massively influence your gameplay. That's really unlucky. Don't take the easy shot. I'm unsure about the positioning there. I like moving out to this flank. Don't get me wrong. I like moving to this position. But you could have taken an easy shot from the Centurion 7-1 or whoever. The Bisonte there, which I wouldn't like. It would have been cheap, you know? So, TD's unspotted, Skoda's still unspotted. I'm expecting that Skoda to appear sooner or later. At this point, he's just waiting, going through his reload, and you can see that autoloader mechanic working. If he had fired, then his reload would have been cut by like 50%, or I can't remember the exact values. But you gotta remember, with these tanks, the deeper you go into your clip, pushing out here, I kinda like this. Doesn't take the shot that could bounce. He knows he has to pen all of these shells here. Really good. Careful. He is very careful with that shot. That's really nice to see. Now, I've got to assume he's communicating with his Pajero here. Or maybe he was paying attention to something that I wasn't and knows that this Emil is reloading. It's also worth noting that this Emil is a one-shot for most people that are shooting at him. Right? The T-30, the Pajero, the AMX. When autoloaders are a one-shot, they are far less threatening. They are far less likely to poke and assert themselves. So, I like the push here. I do. I really like it. Now, retreating out here while still spotted. Ooh. Oh, I don't know about that one, Chief. I mean, if we're looking at the Borsig, we're looking at the SU, we're looking at the Scorpion. Oh boy, my dude, if you want to get out of here, you go forward. Sent 7-1's just fired, he's got the 105 Royal Ordnance Cannon, what's that, 10 second reload? Maybe you take one shot, but it's better than taking the TDs in the side, right? You go forward and back out the way you came. Don't know if you're going to get lucky here, but I'd be very, very worried. Ah, there you go. It's something, it's odd to me, based on the way he's played this game so far, that seemed to be a surprise to him. But hey, we all have lapses in awareness now and then. Now, going for reloads here, at this point, is it worth a blind fire or two? Maybe just one. I wouldn't put a lot of stock into it. because you've got other people in this engagement that are threatening your team, that are more involved in the game than the Scorpion, right? They are a bigger threat to your chances of winning. The Scorpion and the SU, if they're sat back there, then they're not winning the game currently, right? They're not involved, so we want to prioritize here. Are you going to take a shot from the CC? Got Child Bar Pipe. Take one. Okay. Now this is getting very, very messy indeed. How's your platoon mate doing? Getting hammered a little bit, but it looks like he provoked a fire on the SU there. You can see him burning down on the map. Now the Emil goes down, which clears up the flank very, very well. And do you hardcore push this? And now you clip out. I think you were considering there going single shot to keep your DPM high, right, which is viable, but as soon as he took the big T30 shot there, became a one shot, became a kill shot. So absolutely, you go deeper into your clip in this situation, reduce the number of guns shooting back at you, reduce the firepower, and reduce the power of the enemy team as a whole. At this point, you don't have the luxury of time. You are a one shot, but you kind of gotta go and see what you can do. SU is poking, but not quickly enough. And done. Oof. I would have gone for the target there. Risky. So you have 351 hit points. Now, by Bassetto running away, another auto reloader, it's gonna be maybe a 50-50 if he pins you frontally, assuming he's firing standard ammo. I think he has like 212 pins somewhere around there. You could sideswipe it, but at this point, we're still missing the Borsig, we're still missing the Scorpion DG. I would say at this point, it is worth just using aggression, right? The BZ is located somewhere. I don't think you have time in this circumstance to be patient here and sideswipe and kill this guy the way you would normally like to, right? Because of the risk of the flank of the BZ, because of the risk of the flank of the TD. So at this point, I think the best chance of you winning is just saying, okay, I'm just going to believe that he doesn't pen me. It's also worth noting we've only got two heat shells left, so we can't really know the full clip here. Yeah, by Bassetto, by Tonte, not driving like he wants to win a medal there. One shell left, should be a kill, but no. Now you're going to load AP. Come on, you got to notice, my man. There we go, okay. Cool, cool, cool. Adrenaline pumping, perhaps a bit late on noticing. Now let's take stock. So we got 351. Let's look at the alpha damage on the enemy team. What's the BZ like? 800 something, goes up to 900. Just a lot of bullshit, right? Borsig could have 750 with like 324 millimeters of pen with heat, potentially. Could have the 128 millimeter gun as well, 246 up to like 315, is it, with APCR? I can't exactly remember, but it's 490 alpha damage, as is the Scorpion G. Now, I can't see how much health. 36, damn. His friendly Pangilla there could be taken out by any one of these tanks with a HE shell. AMX M451 there, the only tank that can take a hit. So that's what you want to take stock of. And right now, we want to keep the AMX in the game. The AMX at this point is your best chance of winning the game. You want to be surrounding him, making sure you protect his power and protect his influence. Now, I would wonder at this point what the BZ is up to. Because he hasn't made an appearance, not even being spotted at distance. It's possible he could have flipped himself. But they are giving these Pangeros time to reload, which is nice. And now the difficulty is here. I would argue that you are at an advantage tactically against the majority of the enemy team. Borsig's Scorpion, please communicate. Please communicate that. Ping's D7. I got spotted from... I was spotted. The Amex needs to know this info. Pangelo goes down, unfortunate. Oh, it's such a risk poking here. You don't know if it was that BZ that spotted you, or whether it was someone in these bushes here. You pinged d7. I don't know about the poke here. I don't. Because you're not going to get an turn shot, are you? Like, the value of this peak is very, very minimal. Okay, aborted. Nice. I like the abort there. The value was minimal. The risk was very high. Now, can you utilize this mech well? Looks like you're attempting it, which is nice. Where's your HE show? Do you have intuition? That would be an interesting thing, wouldn't it? Full HE. But, I mean, right now, Borsig Scorpion? Like, it's appealing, the notion of getting HE pens. And this Borsig, that looks like the big gun to me. Let me go third person. I just saw a half a second. I hope I'm right. I love being right. Okay, let's have a look. Oh, look at that big old boomstick. So what? 215 millimeters of pen with standard AP 334. 334 with heat. So, dangerous, no mistake, and most certainly a kill shot. But you can clip him. 1,200 clip potential. What's this Borsig going to do? At this point, he should just wait and aim the shot. To be quite honest. MX has a poke. Borsig does get the kill. Oh, stop panicking, stop panicking. He's just fired. Hang on. Were you managing your reload there? I interpreted that as panic, but looking at the way that played out, that may have been reload management. Okay, so let's look. He's reloading. Watch his reload timer. Takes the kill. He's reversing out. I don't think this is panic. 2, 1. No, it might have been panic and luck. But still, that's the kind of thing you want to consider in this vehicle is, you know, hold the shot. If, an example, the Borsig has just fired, right? We know he's got a hugely long reload. If this Pangelo had just fired as well, you know that you are going to beat the Borsig's reload with your first shell, right? So you wait in front of the Borsig, effectively. He can't kill you. You wait in front of him to reload that shell, and then you take the kill. You don't fire your second shell at him because it reduces your overall DPM. And in this situation, when you're outnumbered and there are people coming in at you, you really need to keep your DPM high. Now, at this point, it's worth considering something which I've talked on before. Tanks are less accurate when they're moving, when they're closing in on you. Right? They are less accurate and less likely to connect. So let's say you have a medium tank landing down on you and you're in your light tank. You have a tier 10 medium. If there's no option to like run away, you know he's going to catch you. You should take the engagement with him while he's moving in. You shouldn't wait for him to get in close because he is less likely to hit you while he's closing that distance, while you expose to him, while he's moving at full speed, than he is when he gets in close. Same principle here with regards to the BZ. BZ's gun is not accurate. It's certainly not as accurate. At the same time, it's certainly worse than the Pangelo. So I would be reasonably keen on poking in this engagement, because if I see that BZ moving towards me, I'm going to want to poke quite aggressively. I'm going to be wanting to be quite cheeky, because I reckon that there's an even chance that he whiffs that shot if he takes it not fully aimed. So that's what I want to see here, trying to pressure him as he moves in. No, he is too close. Moves forward. That is lovely. That is really lovely heavy tank positioning. Just moves forward slightly to cut off the shot at the lower plate and to try and get in close quarters where he knows the BZ doesn't have the pen to kill him. Look, the BZ is overpowered and game-breaking. Like, well, I'll say overpowered. It's broken. It's damaging to the game balance. But one thing it is very limited in is its penetration against other same tier and higher heavy tanks. So, really well played. Let's get in here. You cannot overmatch the top with a 120mm gun and the lower plate being trolley. Wait, wait, wait. You can beat this BZ's reload, presumably. Can you? I think you still beat us when you load. I'm pretty sure you do. Someone correct me in the comments. Someone count. But I would be betting on beating this guy's when you load in this situation. Wait. Yes. Wait. No! You ruined it! Why? Oh, no. Okay. So, expecting the flank, no doubt. We got a high health Borsig. Do you insta-load HE after that kill? If you've gone into your second shell, do you check your awareness here and then insta-load HE? What's the value of that? Let's see. Scorpion's got, like, what, 1,100 hit points, I think? You're going to have average damage of 515. On average, you don't two-shot him, so probably not worth it, right? Let me know in the comments, would you load HE in this situation? Once you had cleared the flank, that is. Once you had made sure that you weren't being encroached on immediately. Now, we took a hit from this Scorpion earlier, did we not? We know that he was occupying J1 at some point in this game. Now, the thing is about players of water tanks, they tend to be creatures of habit. So it wouldn't surprise me at all if he was still in the same location, having not popped up in this entire engagement just yet. So it looks like that's what we're banking on as well. Seems to have the notion via his tank's body language and his movements here that that Scorpion is still over in that location. Now, you could probably make your way into the cab at this point. And that might be what we're going for here. Of course, if the Scorpion is a competent player and you do that, you should lose. To a full health Scorpion, you should very, very much lose. And this is a larger risk than you need to be taking right now. If that Scorpion is sat up in the bushes on the edge here, which he should not still be in that wide bush. He should still, if he's still in that position, he should be using the bushes on the side here to overwatch cap. If he's sat there with binos up, most likely you get spotted and you get shut down here. I can't ping, unfortunately, to see the distance. But it's most likely his viewing range would pick you up here. What's the camera rating of this thing? 1.29, something like that. Around 7%. So not going to keep you safe from the Scorpion with binos. You've got 5 minutes at this point. It would have been better to go wide, right? Go around this location and come in right from the corner. That way you have cover of this land while you're approaching the cab. That would have been safer and I believe more logical. That said, looks like you're going to get away with it. At this point, almost everything you do is a risk, right? Everything that you do. But you can get into the cap. Now, if I was a Scorpion and the cap pinged off, I'd know exactly where you were instantly. I wouldn't need any questions about where you were in the cap. I would instantly know. I would come off the hill, I would come down here, and I would communicate to the mid. I'd poke in this doorway, or somewhere around there, maybe around this building, and probably it would be GG, right? Admittedly, I probably have already been dead due to trying something stupid earlier, but hey-ho. Then the still works. 6 kills for Mr. Pangelo. He is well capable of clipping the Scorpion. Of course, the viability of having loaded HE does make you question, you know, the RNG aspect of it. Now, if you're penning a 120mm HE shell on a Scorpion target, you're likely to knock out the gun. Right? You're likely to get some more module damage. So, do you bank on that? Is that a worthy investment at this point in the game? Because even if, I don't know, like, you have to go through the reload, right? If you fire one shell at Scorpion, you have to go through the payload, and Scorpion's fast enough to close and take advantage. But if you're knocking out his gun, and he has to manage his repair kit, manage his med kit, and then... Oh my god. He just fired. Expose. Expose right now. You pull forward, right? You just go forward so that he can't duck behind this cover. Or you just cap. I mean, I'm too bold, to be honest. Like, all you need to do is just cap. And, wow. That was the worst approach that Scorpion could possibly have taken. I do not know what he was thinking. Like, he could have just outspotted this Jello. He could have appeared from the side. Like, if you're on the hill in the Scorpion's position and you can't see him in the cap, like, you do a... you go from here all the way up this bush line and you can't see him, right? And the reason you go all the way up this bush line is to check that he's not being covered by one of these standing trees. If you can't see him, you know he's behind here. You know he's here. That gives you so many options for attack lines, right? Positioning. It's an auto-reloader. You don't want to yellow out against it in a tank that has no armor whatsoever. If you miss your shot, you're fucked, right? You come all the way around, you could be on this corner. You could be here, you could be there, you could be in the middle. I mean, you could even have poked around there, probably give you a better chance. Awful play by the Scorpion. Absolutely awful. But what a splendid game for our gentlemen in the Pungettos. Thank you very much for sending it in. And if you'd like to see your replay looked at by me in this series, you can send it to replays.wolst@yahoo.co.uk. That will be in the description, and I will be happy to add it to my folder, and you might see it in this series one day. Thank you very much, and...
Yes, what's good's a legendary, brutal stuff, like he does a thing. Let's cruise it up. But the World of Tanks is kindergarten, childish software. Real men play armored warfare, PvE. And his business model is actually insane. Making money off of subs but doesn't have to play a game. Also his leadership skills are dope as fuck. He says YOLO up for